welcome to LOA Today. I'm Walt Thiessen. With me today are Alex Scandi and Anne-Marie Young. This is your daily dose of happy. We are so happy you decided to join us today. Dan Mangana can't join us this week, but fortunately, Anne-Marie was available and eager and enthusiastic about joining us. So welcome to the Thursday podcast, Anne-Marie. That's terrific. We're glad you could be
here. It's nice to be here again. It's nice to meet Alex, a kind of person.
Yeah, right. Absolutely. Well, that's what all this stuff is. I mean, how many co-hosts do I have? And I've met one in person and you're looking at her. I mean, that's it. But no, it's all good. So anyway, we were kind of kicking things around about what to talk about today. And Alex was telling us about something that she found that's pretty cool that she's incorporating into her conscious creation life. And Alex, I'm not even going to introduce it. I'm going to let you introduce it. So what is this thing you found?
Okay, so I'm all about TikTok now, like I'm obsessed. And so I scrolled through in the middle of the night with nothing else to do. And I saw this guy who made a sound for, it's called a money mantra. And I liked the beat of it personally. And I was like, okay, this goes kind of hard. All right. And then started listening to the lyrics of it and started learning the lyrics of it, because that's what I like to do. And realize I'm humming it throughout the day, and just it put me in a better vibe. And then I think it was like I posted it, and 10 hours later I did an update and I had $683 show up.
Ooh.
What?
Nice.
Wow.
Yeah.
So can you share this with us?
Of course I can. Please hold. All right, here we go. Hold on. Someone's texting me during my time. All right, ready?
I love that.
Right?
I love it. That is fabulous. And you got a payoff on it instantly. That's pretty cool.
Instantly, yeah.
That's incredible.
And I
take
it.
It's stuck in my head.
Right?
I take it this is what they call blue money. It's money that was completely unexpected. You didn't know where it was coming from.
It literally was.
Wow. Wow, that's really something.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, thank you for the share. Yeah. Now all of a sudden, this is actually going to help bar ratings, because all of a sudden people are going to be playing my possession. That's good. <No. laughs> It's interesting, too, that you found a money mantra, because I've been spending time reaching out to people who are experts in various business fields and so forth, looking for appropriate guests on the show, because I've been deciding I wanted to have us focus more on money lately. And here you are coming with a money mantra, just blowing away everything that I've been doing my research on. So thank you for that.
You know what I could do? I could DM the guy who made the sound and see if he will come on the show.
Yeah, that would be fun.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, give him my Calendly link and see if he can join us on a Thursday or something.
Yeah, I'd definitely do that.
That'd be cool. I'd like that. Get the story about what was behind creating it and what kind of success. I mean, if you've had success, I imagine he's been having success too.
Oh, his whole page is full of everyone's success stories.
Really?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. Any of them stick out in your mind? Like, you remember one particular because of something really cool about it?
No, they don't really like say, they'll just put prices above their head, or they'll be like, oh my God, I can't believe. And then they'll be like, 10 hours, you know, $300, or, you know, stuff like that. Or some people will be like, I had a job show up out of nowhere, or I just got hired for this situation. And I'm like, okay.
and nice. They're getting paid.
Mm-hmm. Getting paid, yeah. That was a nice choice of words, too. I'm getting paid, because that's not a hard one to believe.
Right. Mm.
Right, because so often people pick mantras like, you know, I'm a rich man, and they don't really feel like a rich man, so they just
you gotta
don't
feel it. You got to know what it feels like.
But almost everybody knows what it feels like to get paid. That's very smart.
Mm-hmm.
That's very smart. And it's indeterminate, too. He didn't put a price tag to it.
Nope, he said bigger wage every day.
Different ways.
Yep.
Love it.
Leaving it wide open. That's really good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely try to get him on. He'll be a good interview, I'm sure.
Okay, I definitely will.
Yeah, that'll be really good.
And then I think we should get Dan to do one of these TikToks with his money game.
I wonder if his people's doing TikTok. I don't think so. They totally should. There's lots of Dans on there.
Yeah, but
there's only one Dan Mangana, so.
Right. I'm saying there's lots of Dan-like people.
Dan-like people. Oh, I see.
All right. Life coaches giving advice and stuff like that.
Yeah, there's but Dan's not like most others. He really is.
No, he's not. He's not at all. But what I'm saying is it's out there, so he could like.
Oh, sure.
Definitely do it.
David Strickle does TikToks, and he's had a lot of stuff with them too. But I can just see Dan, if he were into it, I can just see Dan definitely succeeding with something like TikTok just because of what he does with his clients.
Yeah. I mean,
he has an amazing number of people who he has taken to six and seven figure incomes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if he can just find a nice, concise 60-second way, I guess now it's more than 60 seconds, but if he can find a nice, concise way to make it clear that that's what he does, he's going to get a lot of attention.
Well, he does. He already does it on Facebook and Instagram.
I know he does. Yeah. I'm just thinking what happens to the platform. That's all. You know.
I think he should get his guitar out. He's a musician as well. He could get his guitar out, do a little song.
Yeah.
You good?
All right. Good idea.
The Dan Mangana mantra. I'd be curious to see what
that sound.
So. Well, what else has been going on, guys? Anything interesting happening in the life? Well, Alex is still getting used to being a married lady. So, there's no transition period. Although
How's that going, Alex? How's married life?
That's not really a big transition for you.
Married life is great. I'm loving it.
Yeah,
I feel more motivated to do housewife stuff. Like, I'm literally folding laundry while I'm watching The Bachelorette. Like, that's my day. I wash dishes now. That's a new thing.
That's new. Oh, okay.
Yeah, because we had this conversation about how washing dishes is like your relaxing thing. And I was like, nope, I can't put my hands in the water. I can't do it. So I went on Amazon and bought myself some rubber gloves. And now I wash dishes.
Well, one of the reasons we were talking about it is, as Anne Marie knows, in the Thai community, it's considered a very viable, low thought activity if you're, feeling down and need to climb back up again. And that was the context I think we were talking about. So I'm wondering, have you been using it in times where you just need to kind of take your mind off something?
I haven't. I don't think.
Try that sometime.
I usually just do them just because they're there. I'm like, what do I have planned today? Nothing. All right, I guess I'll do some dishes.
Do some dishes.
Those seem to be in the way. All right, let's move them.
Do you find yourself?
Yeah, I know, but I also play music while I'm washing dishes, so it's like a whole vibe.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
You've turned it into a joyous event. That's pretty cool.
Well, yeah, I had to turn cleaning into a joyous event. Otherwise, I wouldn't do it.
I wasn't going to do it otherwise. Yeah, I get that. So now, the way you made it sound, though, being a married lady is not only very good, but it sounds like I'm interpreting here, maybe. It sounds like you're making some plans you didn't make before. It sounds like there's planning going on. Am I wrong about that?
Planning meaning what? Like,
I don't know, but just the way you said it, it's almost like I had this image of you just this very forward-looking thing. Like, okay, I know where I'm going now. Like, this is great. Let's go down there. That was the feeling I got.
Yeah, that's true. We have goals. We have goals. The car dying definitely got in the way of the pushed everything back a little bit, but that's okay. We recovered. And then after that, so after we get the car, then we have to worry about getting the license for the tattoo shop, opening the tattoo shop. Mm-hmm. And then Jamaica 2022.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. Good times. So excited.
Do you have the date? Do you have the date set?
It is August 25th. It's my best friend's wedding. So we're going.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So a twofer.
Yeah, exactly. He was like, bring the whole family. I was like, I'm gonna try. I'm gonna see.
Oh, I had my honeymoon in Jamaica. I loved it.
Oh, I've never been, so I'm excited to go.
Oh, it's, yeah, I thought it was stunning.
Yeah, I'm Jamaican. I've never been to Jamaica.
Anywhere in the Caribbean is gorgeous, but certainly Jamaica has a very unique vibe, no doubt about that. Okay, well, that's cool stuff. This is unusual. I'm not used to having no ideas for a topic. Usually I can just start talking and something happens and it's not really
flabbergasted.
I'm in shock, really.
Oh, did I tell you I talked to Rita the other day?
No. How's she doing?
She's doing good.
Good.
So what happened was, I don't know if we had this discussion about why I never had my surgery.
We did not, no.
Okay. So it was because I had spoke to Rita. So what happened was the weekend before, because I remember I signed off on Thursday. I was like, I'm not going to be here next week. I'm having surgery Monday, blah, blah, blah. Everything was all set up until Sunday. I started feeling iffy. No, Saturday. Saturday, I started feeling iffy. I couldn't tell if it was anxiety or if I was actually, if something was actually going to happen. So I was like, I made all the phone calls. I called all the doctors. Everyone reassured me. And I was like, okay, but you know what? I feel like I should call Rita though. And I did. I texted her and she was like, okay, I'm going to gather some information and we'll text you in the morning with an answer. And she was like, everything looks fine, but if you have anxiety about it, it's not going to come out well. So I wouldn't do it.
Good advice.
Sorry. Yes.
Yeah. Cause you definitely want to go into something like that. High vibe.
I was at 100% fear. So it was not a good idea for me to do it.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. Interesting too, that you were in contact with Rita, because literally just today, somebody posted on the YouTube version of the first show that I did with Rita and Linda Armstrong, where she came on and identified her relationship to Vinnie Gigante and so forth.
Right.
And the commenter was pretty much dissing her, really very disrespectful. So I was kind of handling him. But in the process, it was reminding me of how much I was enjoying when she was on the show. And
yeah,
she made it. And here you are telling me about talking to Rita, you know, within 5 hours, something like that. So that's pretty cool.
We're all in sync. That's all it is.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll have to have
Speaking of weird stuff, Matrix comes out soon.
Oh, the new Matrix is coming out.
It's coming out on HBO Max on the 12th, I think.
Ooh, in time for Christmas. Okay. Have you heard anything about it?
I've seen the previews.
Does it look good?
It looks doable. I had trouble. We already did 3, so I was having trouble seeing where we could go from there. But now it's like, okay, it makes it a little, the trailer makes it a little clearer.
So this is actually supposed to be like the next installment, so to speak. It's not like an independent storyline or something.
Right.
Okay.
Well, so is this the film or a series?
The film.
The film.
Which is a series, which is weird.
It's basically The Matrix 4 is what it amounts to.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Resurrection.
Okay. Resurrection. Yeah, that sounds... Well, that's kind of like a play on words there, because the series kind of stopped a number of years ago, so it's being resurrected.
Yeah.
Do they have most of the original cast?
I'm trying to think who we're missing. I think we're missing the original Morpheus.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Lawrence isn't supposed to be in this one. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. That doesn't make any sense to me.
Scheduling conflict? I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, that was a pretty big movie in his career. I don't think he'd want to just miss that.
Well, who knows what else he's got coming out?
Well, that's true. I have no idea what he has coming out. You're right. It could have been a scheduling conflict.
Could have been.
So. It's kind of unusual, though, when a star member of a major franchise says, no, I'm not doing it. That doesn't give me a whole lot.
It doesn't, but we don't know. He could be sick. He could be, it could be a scheduling conflict. I don't know.
Yeah.
It could be something else we have no idea about. This could be something behind the scenes.
Yep. Well, okay. Anyway, that gives us something to look forward to for the holiday season. So that's going to be cool.
Right?
Yeah. JB says, I would enjoy hearing positive manifestation stories if you guys have any.
All day.
Well, all right. Well, start us off then.
Not talking about things that happen to me is my favorite thing to do.
Just everything you do.
Let me see. What's the most recent manifestation? Well, did he miss the conversation we had earlier about the money mantra? Because that was $683 right there.
Yeah, that's true. And that was a pretty cool one.
Yeah.
683 out of thin air. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, actually, I'm kind of working on one right now because I don't know. Did I tell you, Anne-Marie, I'm finally on module 16, so I'm about ready to go into the graduation mode.
Yeah. Whoa.
And
graduation mode.
Yeah. And as you know, when you're doing the last module, you put out three intentions, and you want those 10 intentions to be kind of like a test to see how you're doing. Are you actually able to get what you're asking for and so forth? And they challenge you to do something easy, but also something tough, you know, something that's challenging. And, you know, go for something like, you know, money or weight loss or something like that. I set my intentions on Monday. And I actually still have a little more work to do because you have some journaling and I haven't done all the journaling yet. But I set my intentions on Monday. And I set one easy one, one medium hard one, and one really challenging one. Mm-hmm. The easy one was just, it's, you can't even hardly call it manifesting because it's more like, what am I going to do every day? But my intention was, I want to do my daily routine every day, this routine that I've developed through Taya. So I want my meditation. I want to do my affirmations. I want to do my appreciations. I want to do my mirror work. I want to do my vision board. I want to do the whole thing every single day. And I've been, not 100%, but I'm doing pretty good. I get at least 3 or 4 of them done out of 5 on my list. So, you know, that one's fairly easy to hit. The second one was more interesting and more fun. I told about this just yesterday, I think. The gardening business, when the season ends, there's always a few customers who haven't paid their bills, and you just have to kind of do collections on them. Well, we closed the gardening season on October 31st, and here it was the end of November. As a Monday, and it was like November 29th, and we had 4 customers that hadn't paid their bills. So I said, okay, well, let's make it. That's one of my manifestation requests. I'm going to intend that all 4 are going to pay their bills by a week from today, which would be this coming Monday. Mm-hmm. And you know, within an hour of making that manifestation request, 3 of the 4 checks came in.
Of course.
Wow.
Yeah. So that was pretty cool. And then I think it was 2 hours after that, I got a phone call from the 4th one, who was the one I'd been trying to reach the longest. It had been more than 2 months trying to get a hold of this person, and they weren't responding to mail, phone messages. They don't even have email. I mean, it was just, you know, do what you can to try to reach these people. They finally got in touch, and there's a whole story there that wasn't all that fun to deal with because basically they underpaid and they won't pay the difference, but at least they paid the bulk of it. So I'm counting that one as, okay, I got a 4th check. So
that's still a win.
I got 4 out of 4. So that counts. Yeah. So I got 2 out of 3 done. The 3rd one is a money manifestation. Like yours, cause I'm in the middle of Dan McGaina's money game. I have completed 6 of the steps so far. And so my next level is 25. God bless you.
Bless
it's
you.
$2,500 or more. So. And it's been a while since anything has happened there. So that's what I'm going for right now. So I set the intention. I even put a date on it. And if I don't hit the date, it's not a big deal. But I set the intention. I want $2,500 blue money to show up out of clear blue sky by December 15th. Stay tuned.
Okay.
And all you got to do is now just sing that. I get paid every day. I get
yeah,
paid.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Well, you have to remember it can come in any way, shape, or form. So if you get a coupon for $2,500 off of siding on your house, that still counts.
Okay. I actually go by the Dam and Gainer rules. Dam and Gainer rule says that.
That's what he told me. Wait, okay. Say that again.
It has to be something you can actually spend.
Okay. But you can spend a coupon.
Can we slice and dice this a little bit more?
Oh, JB said he did miss it.
Yeah, okay. So that explains that. But that was a cool one, though. Your 638, whatever it was that showed up.
600 and something dollars.
Over 600. That's good enough. Yeah, we'll go with that. So yeah, those are pretty good manifestations. Have you had anything lately, Anne-Marie? Anything show up? Anything interesting?
Yeah, I'm not the best at manifesting money, so we're working on that one. I just had things like I've always wanted to make a Christmas wreath because I like crafty stuff, and mm-hmm. I kind of try and do more experiences mm-hmm. like and have fun with friends and things. So my friend surprised me with a wreath making thing. So yesterday we were there drinking red wine, getting in the Christmas nice. Spirit and making a Christmas wreath. So that was really good fun.
Yeah.
So I always count like things like that as a win. And just like this morning I had a contract at work and it was just like, oh, it was being a pain. I'm just like, do you know what? I just really want to go with this supplier and it just to be done. And then but literally half an hour later, that was the decision. So it just kind of set the intention of like, yeah, I want this to happen with this. Mm-hmm. And it happened, mm-hmm. which I didn't think That's it was good. Going to. So yeah.
That's very good. Yeah. No, that counts. Absolutely. Yeah. It doesn't have to all be about money. There's lots of things that can be a challenge.
Oh, yeah.
So mm-hmm. absolutely. That definitely counts. JB's got a question. I'll throw up on screen so you guys can see. JB says, Walt, do you find it difficult to be doing these different programs at the same time? Do you find conflicts between the different kinds of teachings? No, I actually don't. I mean, I have seen that different programs and different approaches and different teachings do have variations that could conceivably be considered conflicts, but I don't know. I'm always able to iron them out for myself. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really the key. I mean, anytime I'm evaluating any of this stuff, I ask about not is it objectively true, is it true for me? Does it work mm-hmm. for me? And that's the way I'm always thinking about it. So, and most of the time, it's all overlapping. Most of the time, it's in congruence with each other. I mean, the tie that's off of the Stream of David, which is David Strickle channeling source energy in the form of the stream. And you have Esther Hicks channeling Abraham. And there are differences between the two, but you know what? I haven't found anything that contradicts each other. They all kind of work very nicely together. Mm-hmm. I'll bring in the teachings of Neville Goddard and very different approach, different way of thinking about things. But you know what? The overlaps are still there.
Yeah.
They just call it different things. They have different ways of describing True. It, ways of discussing the same thing. So I don't really run into a whole lot in the way of conflicts. I mean, how about you guys? Anne-Marie, have you experienced conflicts between Thai and other stuff that you've done?
No, I wouldn't say I have. I think I just kind of take what works for me because Thai has got like is a big bag of toys and you just take what toys you want to play with and then you find other stuff and you just take what works for you or what complements or what you're drawn to. So I think you can just pick and choose what you want to do and just make it work.
Yeah, I think so. JB also asked about Taya and Dan's money game. They really address different things. I mean, Taya is mainly about overcoming blocks. It's about learning how to appreciate the stuff that you would normally consider to be non-appreciable and thereby letting it kind of melt away. Whereas Dan doesn't actually address blocks. He's all about, with the money game, it's all about just training yourself to believe you can attract larger and larger amounts of money starting from a small amount. Mm-hmm. So it kind of bypasses the whole question of blocks entirely. So they're really not, there's not much of an overlap on those two, I don't think.
But it can also complement, because you can work, if you've got a money block, you can work on that entire and ignore that and then play Dan's money game and sort of build that belief.
Yeah, no, that's true. In fact, now that I think about it, I'm wondering, now that I've done some tire work, I'm wondering if the money game is gonna kind of, I don't know, it's been on hiatus for a bit. It's like
easier.
A lull. It's been quite a lull going on. I mean, I had a nice hit in July or August, and then that was the first one I had in, like, I don't know, 6-9 months or something like that. So it's been long amounts of time between them. So does this mean that now that I've been working on my removing blocks with the tire, that all of a sudden the money game starts to pick up, gain some steam? That could very easily happen.
Excuse me, sir. Did you not just say earlier that you just got 4 checks?
That's true.
This is you not noticing all over again.
Did get those 4 checks, but those were expected.
Mm-hmm.
It's a money game. It's unexpected. It's stuff that you didn't expect to get. I was expecting to get them. I was hoping to get them. It was not something that was going to be a surprise if it showed up.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a question of, was it actually going to show up?
Okay. All right.
Valid question. Especially given my history, because I have a long history of overlooking manifestation.
This is what I was like, no, yeah. I don't seem right.
Very, very valid question. No doubt about that. In this case, I think I'm safe in saying, well, they're really different things. That's actually kind of the interesting thing about Dan's approach, because it's all about blue money, fun money, just money that you didn't expect. And I don't know about you guys. For me, it was fairly easy for me to believe that small amounts of money like that would show up. And it did. It showed up pretty quickly. I mean, I went through the first 3 or 4 levels very quickly. And then you start getting to the point where you have your real, what Dan calls your edge, your limit of believability that you're trying to stretch out. And as you start hitting that one, then all of a sudden you kind of come to a halt.
Yeah.
And now it's about being patient and just letting go and trusting and so forth. And then you have your next breakthrough, and then you have the next breakthrough and so forth. So that's kind of what I think has been happening here. But I also expect that what the tie approach taught is going to make it easier for me to kind of get it going again with the money game.
That sounds legit.
Yeah, I think it's definitely going to happen. So we shall see. And there are going to be opportunities for it coming up. I know of at least a couple of opportunities that I don't really know what to expect money wise, but there could be some really cool money coming in. Let's put it that way. Is that sort of like half expected?
I was going to say, it's your wording there. Well, the money is going to come in.
The money is going to come in. That's true. Yeah. The money is already here.
I can feel it.
Well, Jackie was telling a story about that yesterday. What was it? She was talking about a client of hers who had, I think she'd actually been doing a mantra, something about she wanted to be surrounded by money. And within a very short period of time, and after doing some work with Jackie as her coach, she was raising her vibe and got to the point where she decided to like clean up around the house. And as she cleaned up around the house, she kept finding things like gift cards that had money that hadn't been spent on it. And,
nice.
Just there was actually money that was already around her, all around the house, and she didn't know it was. So the money really was literally all around her.
That's not the change in the couch, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, once you start finding it, you say, okay, where else is it in here? What else have I not
seen? Now I'm cleaning everything.
That's right. Get out the ammonia. We're going after the couch next. Here comes the carpet.
I had that on Saturday, though. I went, I've got this little piggy bank, and usually I just put my pound coins in. And I thought I'd cleared it. I thought I'd like emptied it and put it in the bank and whatever. And then I went, kind of just dusted it and gave it a shake. It was like another £20 in there.
Nice.
That's
nice.
Fine.
Yeah. And you said you have money problems. Attracting
money. Well, I don't. I had blocks around money, but they can't be that bad.
That's right. They can't be that bad. That's right. Yeah.
Because I remember when I started Tyre, I was like, I'm going to manifest back the money that I paid for the course. Uh-huh. And then I kept thinking, like, where's this money? And then I was thinking, you have extra money at the end of your wage. You just choose to spend it. You're not noticing it. Okay. If I'd noticed it, it would have paid it. So,
right.
Yeah, because things freed up and the money was there.
Yeah, it's funny how that works. That played a big role in terms of Louise not getting out of debt. That, first of all, when we got out of our own way and simply started, or perhaps I should say stopped, getting all freaked out about when are we going to get the debt paid off.
Right.
Just let it go. And then spent more time just getting into a high vibe space so that, you know, I was more consistently attracting more of what I liked. Mm-hmm. And then it just kind of started to fall into place. I talked about this a lot last spring when we actually reached zero, how I couldn't even account for all of it. Mm-hmm. And I'm really good at math. I'm very good at math. I'm one of the few people who actually keeps books on all the money that he spends. You know, I have like a computer program that I've been tracking everything for years. And I went back over it to try to figure out how I ended up paying it off. And I was able to account for about 80% of it, but I couldn't account for the other 20%. Like, where did that come from? I didn't understand. Well, I did actually figure it out.
Oh, yeah?
Where it came from was being high vibe, literally.
Duh.
And the reason I say that, the reason I say that is when you're not high vibe, where are you? You're medium or low vibe, right?
Mm, right.
When you're low vibe, you manifest things that can often cost you money.
Mm-hmm.
So what was happening was less and less stuff was showing up as an unexpected expense. It wasn't that there was more money coming in, it was there was less money going out.
Got you. Okay.
Good point.
And I had not thought about that. And then what really blew my mind, it was 20% of the debt. That was a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, at the very peak, and I talked about this the other day with, who was I talking about it with? I can't remember. Maybe here on the show. I think I was talking about it with you, Anne Marie, on Monday. When you asked me about what was like my lowest point or something like that. And I told you
we were talking about fears, about starting the business and starting the podcast, weren't we?
Right.
And you hit your lowest point.
And I hit my lowest point at around the time just before I started the podcast. It was one of the reasons for starting the podcast. And at that point in time, we were about $65,000 in debt. So over time, 20% of that ended up getting paid off just by being high vibe. 20% of $65,000, that's about $10,000, a little over $12,000.
That's a lot of money, man.
But it was all stuff that, you know, over the time, and you know how it goes. It's not necessarily in large chunks. You know, you get in a bad mood and so you end up buying more ice cream. And then, you start bad mouthing somebody and you have an accident and you have to go to the emergency room. And it's like little things. They just kind of add up over time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where it was going. It was amazing how much it adds up. And when you remove yourself from that low vibe space and you're no longer having to cover your extra expenses, there's a whole lot more money to go around. So I actually got a pretty good education about why it is the high vibe works so much better. It is literally moment to moment.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good to see it in that perspective, isn't it? Just because it might not be flowing to you physically.
Right.
It's vibration wise, it's making a massive difference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is why I think we get so confused about it. This is why it seems like manifestations don't happen. They actually do happen. We're just looking in the wrong place.
Mm-hmm.
All I had to do, I was looking for money to come in. All I had to do was look at the money that was going out.
Right.
Which we don't think of as income, right?
Mm. True.
Because it's an expense. It's going out.
Not as much of it, which means you're saving it, which means,
yes. Yeah. And that's a big deal. That's a really, really big deal. So yeah, there's mm-hmm. actually a very strong, direct, traceable connection between being high vibe and lowering your expenses.
And if that's not an incentive to be high vibe,
right?
What is?
What?
Because when people have blocks, what is it they're worried about? Oh God, how am I going to pay the bills this month?
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they don't dare get specific about what the bills are because they figure that's going to make them even more low vibe. See, this reminds me of the Taya practice. What is it we do in Taya, Anne Marie? We detune. How do we detune? We actually take a look at whatever the thing is that's bringing us down.
You explore it and you appreciate it. Yeah.
Well, I certainly found a way to appreciate not having to pay for all that stuff because I wasn't low vibe anymore. That wasn't hard at all. That was pretty darn easy. Yeah.
And I think it was probably about a year ago, Walt, that I wrote to your show in the fact that my husband had lost his job. He hadn't got another one. He was a main earner. And I was like, oh, panic. And a year later.
I remember that now. Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us how that worked out.
Well, he officially got made redundant on the 1st of January, started a new job on the 19th of January.
So in American terms, he got laid off on the 1st.
Laid off, yes. Yeah, right. So he got laid off on the 1st. But he had a bit of warning that it was going to happen. Mm-hmm. So that's what the worry was about. And then got another job. It's a year contract, so that finishes this January. That's being extended with a permanent job in hopefully Ooh. 6 months
Ooh.
and a promotion and Very a bonus. Nice. So it's not the bad situation that I thought. It all worked out. And I also wrote to Rita. Rita answered the question. She was like, he's been waiting for this, and he so was.
That's fabulous.
Yeah, so yeah, all worked out
as it
all look back on that, oh, I have no doubt when you look back on that, because you remember what it was like, what you felt at that particular point. If now that you know what happened, what could you have said to yourself at that point to feel better, to get into a better space?
I was trying everything out, but I think I would just, it's the trust, isn't it? Just relax and trust and appreciate, you know, that change isn't necessarily a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
Change leads to more good things more than bad things.
That's a really good point. And that's something we were talking about on the show yesterday with Jackie and Cindy. We were talking about how even when very positive change is available to us, we tend to choose the negative, staying where we are,
mm-hmm.
because it's so familiar to us. Cindy was reiterating what I like to think too, and that is, I don't think of it as a comfort zone. I think of it as a familiar zone. It's so familiar that no matter how uncomfortable it is, we'll do whatever we can to stay there.
Right.
But what a wonderful shift it is when we start thinking about change as being a good thing, instead of something that's scary or uncomfortable or difficult or, oh, I don't know if we can manage that. What happens when we start thinking of change as exciting, enticing, intriguing, fun, an adventure?
Well, that's what it is, isn't it?
It is, yes.
Well, it is. It's the ultimate adventure, mainly because none of us know how the adventure is going to end. So it's always an adventure. Yeah, it's really about letting go.
Right.
That's what letting go is. Letting go is just letting the adventure play out.
Hmm.
It's also great evidence of just how useless worry is.
Oh, my gosh.
I've still yet to find out what there's got. I keep trying to find a way to appreciate worry because I'm trying to appreciate everything. That's the Taya concept. You want to appreciate everything. I haven't found anything good about worry yet. Have you guys figured anything out that's good about worry?
I wouldn't say what's good about worry, but like I've found ways to work around it.
Sure. Oh yeah. So,
like if a situation pops up, I'm like, I play this little game with myself called worst case scenario. So you go to the very worst case, like, okay, I'll die. But also, what else could happen? And then what's the next level of could happen? And what's the, until you get to the point where it's like, or nothing could happen.
Yes.
Ah.
That's really something too. When that's the worst case scenario, nothing happens.
Yeah.
Whereas Kevin says, let it go, let yourself go slow and low. That is the tempo.
You made Walt rap. How dare you? But it's good and catchy.
But do you find what now? Sorry. What since you've been doing tire, you worry less, or would you say that's still the same?
Oh, yes. Well, I had made it a point to worry less anyway. That was something that I've been working on for quite some time. But Taya, oh yeah, worry isn't even part of it too much anymore. It doesn't show up anymore. It's very unusual if that happens. There are times that I get angry or frustrated, but worry. About the closest I can think of that I come to worry is when I start musing on how things aren't working real well. But it's not like I'm really worrying about it. It's just more like, oh, this hasn't worked yet. Come on. Hurry up. Come on. Let's go. How about you? Do you find yourself worrying?
Not so much. I've had a few pity moments recently, I have to say, and I need to kind of get out of my own butt really for that. But worrying, no, because I just know if it's not here, it's coming. If it's not here, it's not the right time. And it just feels so uncomfortable to worry now that I just don't want to do it.
Yeah, right? I know that. Yeah. It's interesting. I have this little thing that I do. I've always been very good with numbers. I can do calculations in my head very easily and so forth. But I also like doing things on paper too, or actually, you know, on a spreadsheet on a computer. And in the past, that used to be a way for me to start fretting about it. Because I'd add things like, you know, the income didn't add up to the outgo or something like that. You know, so I turned into something. Now it's actually turning into a fun game of, wow, this could play out this way. That could play out that way. It's an entirely different way of looking at it. And I think a large part of that is because of the Thai experience. Because I'm thinking about it differently now. Because really, any tool you can use anyway. I mean, right? Yeah, a tool is just a tool.
Exactly. Forgot what I was going to say. But I've also taken a lot of the pressure off myself. The fact that rather worrying about my kids all the time and what they're experiencing at school, and because I've got no control over it, I let it go. It's their experience and they can cope with it and it will make them stronger. And it's taken a lot of responsibility off my shoulders. So I've not got so much to worry about as I used to.
Wow. That's a huge breakthrough. That's one that a lot of parents have trouble not hanging on to, letting go of. Parents, so many parents just, they'll worry, you know, their kids right through high school, college, into young adulthood. You know, by the time the parents are, you know, in their 80s, they're still worrying about the kids in their 50s. I mean, it can go on for a lifetime. So letting go of that, that's big. Yeah, it is a vicious cycle. Yeah. So that's huge.
My eldest one at the moment, she's done some math tests. She's worried. She's worrying herself. So it's just like, fine, we'll get a tutor in. We'll solve it. It's fine. It's not a problem. Let's not make an issue of it.
Exactly.
Wow. Really good. That's big. That's the kind of thing. If I were you, I'd be celebrating that every day. That's an appreciation. That's something to appreciate big. Because, boy, that's a huge shift. A huge. Well done.
Thank you. But they're also a lot calmer when I'm not worrying.
Well,
it doesn't ripple out to them.
That's right. Yeah. That's the benefit. Very good. Oof. Wise words.
That was a whole word.
It was. Kevin, you got a rap for that one? That one deserves a rap right there. I'm throwing down the challenge. Let's see what he can do.
So Anne-Marie is feeling the chi.
Love it. All right. Oh, Let's see. Kevin's throwing something up here. Let's put it on screen. Well, I've been doing my three appreciations meditation the past 2 weeks, still having trouble slowing down for meditation. I think I'm trying to force it. Ooh, I think we can help with that.
Yeah.
Want to take a shot, Anne-Marie?
So one thing we do in Thaya is just take very deep breaths and we count to eight. So you breathe in, count to eight, hold for eight, breathe out for eight, and hold for eight. And just keep doing that. And what you're doing is concentrating on the counting, is taking your mind from whirring away. So every time you feel that your mind is going off, then just start counting and just calm your mind down.
I actually varied that for myself because doing it 8888, the way you were describing, put me close to passing out. So I said, no, this isn't going to
work. I changed my eight because I don't do 1, 2, 3, 4. I do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I've got asthma. I was literally passing out.
And I've eliminated the fourth one too. So I just do breathe in, hold, and breathe out, and then go immediately to breathe in again. I don't do that fourth one anymore.
Because do
I don't want to be eight count without oxygen in the body. Listen, I look at you're taking money, you're taking the oxygen in for an eight count, you're holding it for an eight count. So there's like 16 count where there's either air coming in or being held in the body. Then there's an eight count where you're expelling it, and then an eight count where you don't get any at all. No, sorry, that doesn't work for me.
I quite like that one because that just like, again, I'm focusing just on the numbers, so that's what I know in that one, my head's clear, but again, you find what works for you. It doesn't have to be eight. It could be six. And like, I've got this little tune. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know.
That's good. Yeah. And I actually have gotten to the point. I don't even think about it as an eight anymore. I think of it as breathe in, hold, breathe out. There's no values attached to it. It's just breathe in, hold, breathe out. And that's enough. That works really well. So I go with that. But yeah, I mean, that's a really good approach. Another way to slow down for meditation is to meditate with music in the background. And by music, I don't mean like something with a beat. I mean something that's very ethereal, you know, space music, that kind of thing. Something that isn't going to distract you.
My mind wanders.
Say that again because your signal got a little bit funky there.
Oh, I said, yeah. See, I don't know what's with my signals today. Anyways, yeah, I said I can't. Music, ethereal music, doesn't work for me. I get, my mind just wanders.
Oh well, okay. I mean, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. That's fine.
I think the counting would work for me though, for at least 5 seconds. I can't concentrate like that.
Actually, it probably would. If you find your mind wandering because of the music, the counting probably would make a difference.
Yeah, I think it would definitely work better for me than the music would.
Because it's basically the equivalent of low thought activity. I mean, how much thought is there in counting? It's not a whole lot. It's pretty straightforward. One, two. It's not.
You don't have the brain that I have, though.
Well, I know, but nevertheless, I mean, how many different ways can you think about four? I mean, let's be honest. It's just four is four. Yeah, try the counting. That probably worked for you.
Yeah.
Trying to think.
I was going to say, Debbie G mentioned some healing sound meditations. So you've got your bowls and it's different vibrations and just sitting back and just feeling the sounds. So it's similar to music, I guess, but you're just feeling it rather than thinking it. That I found really useful as well. I quite like just meditating to those ones rather than just the music. Because you can feel the vibrations change and you can feel your body change and you're just noticing it rather than what's going on in here. I enjoyed that.
And Alex, you said something actually that cued something in my mind about how the mind wanders. And it reminds me of something Cindy Chavez once told me about that. Actually, she said it a few times since then. But she pointed out that when your mind wanders, that's not a bad thing. We have a tendency to treat that as, oh, I'm ruining it. I'm doing the meditation wrong. But we're actually not. That's actually part of the process of slowing the mind down. So really, it's when the mind wanders. Okay, it wandered. Pull it back. It wanders again. Okay, pull it back. very gently. No muss, no fuss. Just okay. Mm-hmm. Water. Go back. Come right back. Go back to the breathing. Focus on the breathing again. Just keep bringing it back. Because when you do that often enough, all of a sudden it decides to stop wandering.
Yeah.
And I think the same thing is true with slowing down. Slowing down really is all about your mind is still going off in 1,000 directions.
Yeah.
And so that's why it feels like everything's moving really fast. So it's just a systematically over time, noticing every time that your mind wanders, noticing every time that your mind is going off on some thought process that you really don't want it to be on. Say, oh, I caught it. Okay. Mm-hmm. Bring it back to focus on the breathing. And then you notice the next one that went off in the wrong direction. Nope, that's not where I want to go. Bring it back.
Yep, not there.
Yep. Breathing. Here we go. Yeah. Breathing. Come on. Over here. Breathing here now.
And it does get easier though, doesn't it? I think the more practice, you train your brain to wind it down.
Mm-hmm. Kevin also says he's tried mirror work and it kind of trips him out. I know exactly what you mean. And the same answer is there too. He says, how do you do it? How do you get past the point where it trips you out? You do it every day. Even though it's tripping you out, you do it the next day and the next day mm-hmm. and the next day. Because if you do it every single day, you get to a point where all of a sudden it doesn't trip you out anymore.
So what do you mean by tripping you out? Because mirror work is where you... Is affirmations talking to yourself in the mirror? Is that right?
And that's hard to do for some of us. For me, it was really hard the first few times I did it. I mean, literally, I've told this, and it's kind of a funny story, but I've told this story before. My first day doing mirror work was to look in the mirror, look in my own eyes and say, I love you. Oh, God, I can't do this, and walk away. That was my entire session. Because it was uncomfortable. Now, when I do my mirror work, it's, I love you, and I have no mistake.
Because I've done it before, and I kind of just like stare in the mirror, and I just go, all right, kiddo, looking great today. Yeah. Positive day today, and just literally like, winking at myself.
That works. That's great. That works fabulous. Yeah, it's just doing it over and over again. All you're really doing is desensitizing yourself.
Yeah.
Because we start the stuff feeling sensitized, like, oh, I can't really say any of that stuff to myself. And every time I do, I wince and so forth. But that's just being sensitized. Yeah,
you need your internal hype man. That's what you need. Because that's what I do. I'll walk by, I'll be walking through the house, see a mirror, and I'll be like, oh, who's looking? All right, I see them jeans. Look at you go. All the way up there.
Now, I'm only in that mirror. If I was in a full mirror, I'd be having a whole different conversation. So I need to do that.
Well, we know what your husband needs to get you for Christmas.
I have full mirrors in my house for that reason.
Oh, that's all right. Yeah. You move to the next size mirror when you're ready to move to the next size mirror. Actually, when we went to your wedding, Alex, when we were in the hotel room, they had a full-size mirror there. And it was a full-size mirror. It actually worked for me. It went, you know, all the way up to the ceiling. Yeah. So I actually got
to ask about that, though. It's unusual.
You know? And I was taking advantage of it. Now I was liking it. It was like, oh, this is pretty cool. I like this.
Right?
I want to get one for my house.
I said the same thing when I saw my mirrors. I was, it was ceiling-to-floor mirrors. So I was like, oh, I got to get one of these. It was like a dance studio in my room. I was like, okay.
Yes, it is. Like, yeah, where was the bar? I needed the bar. Other than that, it was a dance studio.
Yeah, exactly.
That's funny. But mirror work is a challenge at first. There's no doubt about it. It's just a question of desensitizing yourself over time. And you can. It doesn't actually take that long. I saw somebody post something about, I don't even remember what the process was, something that they were trying. They tried it for 2 days and hadn't gotten a result. And I didn't even think twice about it. I instantly replied, anything that you try, do it for 30 days. I don't care what the thing is. If you're going to try it for 30 days. Otherwise, you haven't tried it.
Right.
Give yourself a chance. Get enough data. 2 days isn't enough data. It's just
I'm making that commitment for 30 days. I'm going to stand in my full-length mirror and I'm going to be positive.
Ooh, there you
just,
go.
Just not just there the weed go. One. Thanks, Alex. I'm gonna do it.
All right, that's good. Yeah, 30 just days.
Something different each day of what you appreciate about yourself.
Yeah, mix it up.
Yeah,
exactly.
It's like Tyler. There are no rules. Do it whatever way you want to do it.
Yeah. I appreciate the small mirrors. That's what's gonna be. Yes.
Okay. Hey, small mirrors are better than no mirrors. So. But that's 30 days.
Kevin's committing as well.
Oh, well, there you go. Okay. Very good.
And oh, JB. Brilliant. JB.
All right. Very good. I like it.
Brilliant.
Really, really good. Yeah, that 30 days. The reason I think 30 days is so important is because of how neuroplasticity works. Neuroplasticity is the ability of the human brain to modify itself, to modify its physical arrangement, so to speak, to basically deliver new thought patterns. Mm-hmm. And it also is how we're able to rewrite those neural pathways that have those old tapes playing that we don't like. Mm-hmm. Well, neuroplasticity takes a little time. It doesn't happen instantly. You have, especially if you've been writing, if you've been playing the same tape over and over again for 30 years, it's deeply ingrained in that portion of the brain. So you got to kind of give it a little time to unwrite and rewrite the new stuff. But 30 days is usually enough to at least give you a feel for where it's going. And often to give you large results, not always, but certainly 30 days, after 30 days, you'll feel something shift. I remember one time we had one email from a listener who tried to do mirror work for 30 days and said that he wasn't getting anywhere. Nothing was happening. But even then, when I dug a little bit deeper with him, I found out, well, he had had some progress. It just wasn't as much progress as he wanted.
Ah.
That's where you have to say,
that's where we get in our own way.
Yeah. The miracle isn't that nothing happened. The miracle is that something did happen and he didn't notice it.
Mm-hmm.
I speak from experience on that.
I was just going to say that. Walt knows.
I do. Very, very well. I am the expert at not noticing. So take it from somebody who knows how to not notice. You're very good at it. You've already mastered that skill. The trick now is to learn how to notice.
Right.
Or as I was saying to, who was I saying it to the other day? We're all masters. Every one of us, we're masters. We don't think of it necessarily that way, but we're masters. Mm-hmm. We're masters at manifesting. We're masters at creation. How do I know? Look what we created. Look at this life form. Yeah.
Right.
Damn, we're good. That's the way I like to look at it, that we're all so good at this. Mm-hmm. All right, well, you know, considering we didn't have a topic, we did pretty good.
I agree.
Yeah, fun.
Coming up with the stories of, you know, what we have manifested and addressing questions about how do we do things that we've had trouble with. No, that's good. Oh, we got one last message from Kevin. What's he saying? Affirmation, mirror work, meditation, vision board exercise. I'll journal and update in 30 days. Good vibes. All right, then.
Excellent.
All right, then. Very good. So we'll expect
that. That'll be great. That'll bring you right into the new year.
That's right. Yes. Mm-hmm. A perfect New Year's story. So, Kevin, we expect to have that email.
Right.
No, yeah, I want to hear that.
But seriously, if you do have a good story to tell, we'd love to hear it. In fact, that's true for anybody. If you've got something that you, a question that you want us to address or a story you want to share or whatever, right now, unfortunately, the app isn't working, but just send me an email, walt@lowaytoday.net, and we will definitely incorporate into the show. So by all means, share the story. Stories are fun. Stories are good. Thank you, guys. Appreciate everything. Thank you, live streamers, for all your input. Good input today. I like the input. And thank you to our podcast listeners everywhere. We will see you all next time here on LOA Today. Goodbye, everybody. Bye.